introduce Dr. Michael Turner from KADLEC'S own Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation. Is that right?
Yes.
And very excited about the topic. So I'm just going to turn that over to him and let him go.
So the title of today's topic is Regenerative Injections for Arthritis, Ligaments, and Tendons. Okay? Regenerative injections. These are things that can actually help regenerate these tissues. All right, and there are two main procedures, two main injection types that we're talking about. One is called prolotherapy. How many of you have heard that word before? Just, you know, okay. Okay. And then the other one is platelet-rich plasma, which goes by the acronym PRP. How many of you have heard of PRP before? Okay, a few people, great. So let me give you a little bit of my background, and then we'll get right into it, okay? So I grew up in California in the Bay Area, and I didn't grow up wanting to be a doctor necessarily, but I always grew up interested in exercise and fitness and being healthy and just eating right, and, you know, how could I be as healthy as I should be, you know? And so I was always asking myself questions like that, and actually I remember when I was in eighth grade, my parents bought me a set of dumbbells and started lifting these weights, and I started looking at my muscles, and you know, and then I start asking questions like, well, how, I know I should probably be eating more protein, you know, how much protein should I be eating? And like, oh, my muscles are pretty sore now the next day, you know, how long do I need to wait before I work out again? You know, and I know that muscles has a lot of collagen in it, and collagen is, vitamin C is very important for collagen synthesis, so do I need to take some extra vitamin C, right? And so one question kind of led to another. It's like, do I need to eat some bananas because potassium, you know, because this? And so this started my whole journey towards being as healthy as I could be, exercise, you know, eating right, and that type of thing. That also segues, however, into injuries, okay? So I like to say, you know, all my own injuries I've caused, basically. You know, I was never in a car accident. You know, I never had anything happen to me. I caused my own problems, basically, overdoing certain kinds of workouts and, you know, this type of thing. So I've had some shoulder problems in the past, some back pain and all that. And that's given me, of course, personal insight and I think empathy into a lot of these situations. Just for example, it was during medical school, I was 26 years old. I remember I was having plantar fasciitis so bad on my foot that I couldn't do anything more than just walk, not even a brisk walk, okay? And I was living in Boston, I was going to Harvard Medical School, and I didn't have a car, so I have to go walk to the bus, walk to the subway, you know, walk from there to my destination, walk back to the subway, walk back to my stop, walk back to my apartment, okay? There's a lot of walking going on here. And I remember feeling so frustrated one day. I'm walking down the street and I'm limping. I'm like, I'm 26 years old. You know, I'm a medical student at Harvard. And I'm limping down the street. My foot's not working right. You know, and this is so frustrating. My friends want to go play basketball. I can't play basketball. I cannot do anything more than walk right now. I mean, if a mugger tried to run after me, I would just have to just limp like this. That was as fast as I could go. And, you know, how many of you have had plantar fasciitis, for example? Okay, you'll know what I'm talking about. You get up first thing in the morning, you put your foot on the floor, it's like, oh, you just feel the worst stabbing pains coming through your foot, right? It's horrible. Well, this is just one example. Plantar fasciitis got cured for me, by the way, by doing yoga. That's what ended up curing it. I started doing hot yoga, and all the stretching from my foot and calf and all that stuff totally fixed the problem after about a couple months. It was fantastic. So this is some interest and personal experience that I had. And then I first got exposed specifically to these two things when I was at the Mayo Clinic. So I did my residency at the Mayo Clinic from 2006 through 2009. And at that time, they were doing, certain doctors were trained in prolotherapy, and certain doctors were trained in PRP. I came in contact with them, spent some time observing them, that kind of thing. The nice part also was that we were trained in our residency in the use of ultrasound for injections, okay? And that's kind of a newer concept. Of course, ultrasound's been around a long time. We know about it for OBGYN, we know about it for thyroid, things like that. But for using it for musculoskeletal purposes, like putting it on a shoulder and seeing is your rotator cuff torn, or we want to do a shoulder injection, let's make sure our needle's in the right place, right? Those were newer concepts, newer uses of ultrasound that really have been about only for the last 10 years or so. So I was very fortunate. That was actually ingrained into our residency training. So when I came out, I was already very proficient with using the ultrasound, which is very, very helpful. Not all shots require it. Not all shots require it. Some are very straightforward. You don't need the machine, and I don't use it because it's just an expense that's not, you know, ethical to add to the patient's bill in my mind. But when you do need it, it's very helpful. So when I signed up at KADLEC, I said, I want the same machine we had at the Mayo Clinic. I want a good one. You know, I want to do this right. And they did. They got that for me. So it's been great. Well, let's get started here. With a picture, okay? How many of you have seen a picture like this, perhaps? Okay? I was just in an airplane last week flying to Salt Lake City, airplane magazine, browsing through it, picture just like this, right? This is a bad knee on the left, you know, there's bone sitting on bone, and it looks a little too white right here, and all of a sudden we got cartilage, and there's a 1-800 number on there, right? And the business will say something like regenerative healing, regenerative injection, something like that, right? So my question is this real? Right now, May 2015, is this a real possibility? Does this technology exist? Or is this snake oil and hype and, you know, salesmanship and gimmicky x-rays? So it's a fair question. I'm by nature skeptical. Right? I think that's a good thing when you're a doctor. You need to have a critical mind. You need to be a little skeptical. You can't jump on every bandwagon. You've got to evaluate things, right? So I see ads, and I'm kind of like, I'm open-minded, but I'm also skeptical. And it's like, you got to show me the evidence. We got to talk about it a little bit, right? So I wouldn't, if I didn't have the training that I have, I wouldn't necessarily jump right on this and say, that's real. Sign me up, you know? But what I'm proposing today is, yes, this is real. This is not an x-ray gimmick. This is not, you know, anything other than what's actually possible through some injections. These are real pictures, published actually in the Journal of Prolotherapy. You can actually see this picture online if you find it. And this person had a dextrose prolotherapy series of injections in the knee, regrown cartilage. The state of the evidence nowadays, to talk about prolotherapy, for example, it is proven if you do prolotherapy in a knee, number one, it can regrow the cartilage in the knee. This is proven. Number two, it can tighten up the ligaments in the knee. Okay? For example, the ACL ligament, which is injured sometimes and becomes loose, we call that lax in medical language, right? This ACL laxity. You can inject that with dextrose prolotherapy solution, and it's proven to tighten up the ACL. Okay, we'll talk about that a little bit more. Let's start with some foundational concepts. So we talked about healing for these different structures, we have to understand a little bit what these structures are. So let's just talk about what is a tendon, right? One of these things, we hear the word a lot, and we're probably using it in the right way, but I want to just make sure we all have the same common understanding, okay? So what is a tendon? Every single muscle in your body ultimately has the job of moving two bones closer together, okay? That's a muscle's job. Classic example is your biceps is going to move this bone, you know, closer to your shoulder, actually. And it stretches in between. In order to move two bones, the muscle has to attach to two bones, right? That's just logic. Now, what's interesting is the muscle doesn't look the same. It's not shaped the same. It's very different microscopically in the middle of the muscle versus where the muscle attaches. The attachment site is very differently structured. Okay, just look at the Achilles tendon. Can you see this here? I'm going to get out my fun pointer, all right? So I just found this in the back of the hallway, but this is my fun pointer. And sometimes you need something big like this because the laser pointer is just a little too small. Okay, so here we go, Achilles tendon. It starts off as your calf muscle, but as it gets down towards your heel, notice how it changes, right? This changes a lot. This is red. This has a lot of blood flow. It's very, blood vessels in there. It's kind of meaty and thick. And all of a sudden, whoa, what happened? Well, the blood vessels disappear. The collagen fiber density increases dramatically, and it becomes tightly coiled and tightly packed. I want you to think about it like a rope with many strands, okay? Like you're on a ship and you got one of those three-stranded ropes or something like that. That's what your Achilles tendon's like. It's densely packed collagen fibers. They're stranded. They come in there and coil over on each other, and it's one gigantic spring. Its job is to transmit elastic energy. Every time your foot hits the ground, it compresses and it recoils, and that helps propel you forward. Okay? So the calf muscle is structured very different from the Achilles tendon, but there's a seamless transition that occurs. Okay? That calf muscle slowly, microscopically changes to the Achilles tendon and then attaches onto your heel. All right? So a tendon is just that portion of the muscle that attaches ultimately to the bone, okay? But it is very differently structured. Now, it's got a good side and a downside to that structure. The good side is it's very strong. When you walk, you put, you know, 2 times your body weight on each foot, essentially as a round number, okay? When you run, it's even magnified more than that. So this has to be very strong. That Achilles tendon is a multi-stranded rope, as I said. It's very strong. And, you know, it's working well for you from the time you start to walk until, you know, older years. And so that's fantastic. However, it doesn't heal very well if it's damaged, okay? It does not heal very well because it doesn't have as much blood supply as the muscle does. If you tore the muscle or if you just took a scalpel and did a little sample incision right in the middle of any muscle, it's going to heal pretty well because it's got great blood supply. But if you do that on a tendon, see where it's nice and white and thick like that? If you took a scalpel and just went like that, that thing has a darn hard time healing, okay? And that's why I got the name Achilles tendon, because it's kind of this weakness, weak point of the body. It's very hard to heal, okay? And most tendons are like that. Let's go on. What is a ligament? Okay, what is a ligament? Similar idea. Very dense collagen fibers, tightly packed strands, and its job in this case is to just hold two bones together. Okay, so the ligaments of the foot, as you see here, or the ankle are a classic example. There's no muscles involved, but we just got bones next to each other, and we need these bones to hold in proximity to each other. Okay, and so you can think of it like the thread that knits the bones together. Or I describe it in terms of cobwebs. It's almost like thick area of cobweb that's just kind of stuck in there that's holding these bones together. Your foot is a great example because your arch deforms. Every time you walk, it deforms, it stores passive energy, and it springs back. Okay, pretty neat. That's the whole function of your arch. It's supposed to be pliable, to store passive elastic energy, and then spring back. Okay. Well, to do that, something's got to hold the bones together. You can imagine, you can't just have 5 foot bones in parallel. You're just going to kind of splat, and they're going to just stay there, right? So there has to be a springy nature. So that's where the ligaments in your foot are vitally important. And you have ligaments that connect your leg bone to your foot as well, and those are the ankle ligaments on either side. And we kind of see those right up here in this top left corner. Okay. Here's a vitally important concept. These tendons and ligaments can be damaged in certain ways, right? Let's just talk about way number one, stretched, overstretched, okay? Overstretched. A classic example would be like a knee sprain, okay? You know, somebody's running, somebody steps in a hole, something like that, and you just kind of stretch your knee too much. Thank you. There are several ligaments in the knee that can become overstretched. And we grade these things, grade 1, 2, 3, 4, and so forth. Okay? Another example is in the ankle sprain. That's a very classic example, right? You step off a curb, step in a hole while you're gardening or something like that. The ankle twists suddenly, and those ligaments can just become overstretched. If you do an MRI of that ankle, of that overstretched ligament, what does it look like? It looks normal. Completely normal. It's not torn in half. It's not necessarily bleeding a lot. It's not necessarily swollen a lot. It's just overstretched. Just think about like a rubber band that was stretched too forcefully and it lost its elasticity, right? It doesn't spring back like it's supposed to. That's the job of these ligaments and these tendons, to have store elastic energy, be springing. And if they get overstretched, they're not working. But they will look perfectly normal on an MRI. I'm going to show you an example of this later on. But they're damaged, they're not functioning right, and they will hurt. And they need to be treated, okay? Another type of damage that can happen with a ligament or a tendon is it can fray, right? So again, imagine that rope, your coiled up rope. It can get frayed, you know, there's little ends and stuff that kind of split ends on this rope that come up. It can start to fray, so tendons can fray. They can also degenerate from the inside out, okay? We can see this on ultrasound, and the tendon looks mushy. Instead of being tight and densely packed, it's mushy in the inside. The structure of those collagen fibers is kind of degraded to some degree. So that goes by the medical word tendinopathy, if you've heard of that word, or tendinosis, if you've heard of that word. So if a doctor ever said you have some tendinopathy or some tendinosis, we're talking about degeneration of that tendon. It's usually kind of from the inside out. So that's one thing. Another thing that can happen is it can partially detach off of its bone, right? Again, think about the Achilles tendon, which we showed a second ago. Imagine that thing going down to your heel. It can kind of like, you know, partially tear off there, right? It can fully detach off there. That's kind of a catastrophic situation. Okay, a person's not going to be able to walk, but you can have some partial or full detachment from its attachment site. Finally, what can happen is it can partially tear. And by tear, I mean, let's say you have two ends like this. Your tendon can kind of split from top to bottom like a crack through an iceberg or something like this, right? That would be a partial tear. And if it's torn completely full thickness and you have two pieces sitting there, we call that a full thickness tear. This is very common in the shoulder, right? It's extremely common. If you've had shoulder problems and you have rotator cuff problems, your MRI probably says small partial thickness tear of the dot, 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 supraspinatus tendon or something like that. Or it might have said full thickness tear of the whatever tendon. Okay? So there's tearing, either full thickness or partial thickness tearing that can happen. So all those things are ways that tendons or ligaments can start to be damaged, start to degenerate, and they will all create pain. Okay? The next key point I want to make is that a weak tendon is a painful tendon. Okay? A weak tendon is a painful tendon. This is like a mantra to keep in mind. And the same thing for a ligament. A weak ligament is a painful ligament. Okay? And the reason why is your body has receptors that are actually embedded within that tendon. And it tells the body, it tells the nervous system how much strain is going through there at any one moment in time. Okay? And these things are called Golgi tendon organs. Have you heard that phrase before? Maybe if you took a physiology class way back when or something. But there's these things called Golgi tendon organs. And they're little mechanical sensors in the tendon. And they can tell when it's under too much strain. Here's a simple example. Just pull your finger back, right? Pull your finger back. At a certain point, your finger's going to hurt, right? Because too much tension has built up now in the tendons and in that joint. And all of a sudden, it's sending a pain signal to your brain. Hey, there's too much tension in here. Relax. As soon as you take the tension off, your pain goes away and you're fine. Okay, so you have the ability to sense how much tension is in any given tendon or ligament at a certain time. When that ligament's damaged, though, the pain signal goes off a lot sooner. Right? My normal finger, I can bend it back pretty far and pretty hard before I get my pain signal. If this tendon is damaged, as I just start to lift, it's going to hurt. Same thing with my Achilles tendon. My normal Achilles, I can run and be happy. If I have a damaged Achilles, I start to push off, and it knows that it's damaged, and it's like, oh, not safe, sending pain signals to the brain, stop it, something bad's going to happen. You following me? So that's why a weak tendon is a painful tendon. Your body lowers the threshold to start sending pain signals to your brain, and all of a sudden you're going, oh, this hurts, man, I got to stop, which you should. It's kind of a helpful signal for you in that case. Okay? But the converse is also true. If you strengthen that tendon, if you strengthen that ligament, it will stop hurting so much. It will stop hurting so much. It'll go back to more of a normal set point. Okay? Last thing is just to mention, what is arthritis? So this is a picture of a knee, and this is a pretty classic situation for arthritis. And we could talk about this for a long time, but I just want to make a couple quick points, okay? So we know that there's some arthritis is basically a description of degeneration of that joint. And we know sometimes it can be your immune system that's causing a problem. Your immune system's kind of attacking your own joints. Those are autoimmune problems. That's like rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, gout. Your immune system's reacting to something, and it's going around to your joints and creating damage. Okay, but let's set that aside because that's actually the minority of arthritis. Okay, that's like 5% of arthritis, maybe 10%. Don't quote me on that, but it's the minority. So the vast majority of arthritis is what we call osteoarthritis, right? That's basically wear and tear. The joints just kind of wearing out over time. All right. So what happens there? Well, let's look at this knee. The cartilage surface of the knee is very smooth, and it has something called hyaline cartilage. Now, there's different kinds of cartilage in your body. For example, your ear is made out of one kind of cartilage. Okay? But on the surface of the thigh bone and the surface of the top of the shin bone there, that's a different kind of cartilage. It's very, very hard. It's like as hard as an ice rink, actually. And for the engineering types, it has the same coefficient of friction as an ice rink. Okay? It's very slippery, it's very hard, it's very smooth, it's very durable. And so you have those two slippery surfaces just sitting right in there like this. And then you have some things that, of course, hold the knee together to make it stable, okay? But arthritis in the knee, if you imagine your ice rink there, and now imagine some little divots taken out of it because, you know, people skated on it all day, right? Before you bring the Zamboni out, you know, the ice is looking like what? Well, it's got little divots and chunks out of it. It's not so smooth. It's not, you know, it's not in top shape. Another way to think about it is like a putting green, right? If your putting green's not, you know, kept up real well, you got divots, you got chunks, it's not so smooth. That's basically what arthritis is. It's a process of descriptive process of damage to that cartilage. So over time, it's got chunks, it's got pits, it might be bleeding. There might be some exposed bone underneath, as you see in that picture, right? You can kind of see through the cartilage, and you're seeing some bone actually underneath in the knee. This would be very severe. Okay, so that's arthritis. Let me go back and ask you one very important question here before we go on. And the question is inflammation, you guys have all heard of inflammation, is inflammation a good thing or a bad thing? Okay. Okay. Right? Okay, good. I hear some murmurs. This is good. So some people say it's a good thing. Some people say it's a bad thing. Some people say both. Okay, right? So let's talk about that. Inflammation in certain places is a bad thing. It's bad. Okay? Your nervous system, for example, your brain. Inflammation in the brain is a bad thing. It's linked to neurodegenerative processes, okay, such as Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, things like that. Inflammation in the nervous system is a bad thing. You don't want it. Okay. Inflammation that is chronic, that goes on a long time and just sort of hangs out and stays there, that's a bad thing. That's no good. Inflammation is a risk factor for heart attacks. You might have heard of that, which is why they check a blood test called the CRP, or cardiac risk stratification. CRP is a measure of systemic inflammation. Okay, so inflammation that just hangs out is a risk factor for heart attacks. No good. Inflammation that just hangs out in a certain organ or tissue can drive cancer. No good. Okay, but inflammation for a short period of time, we'll call that acute versus chronic, okay? Acute inflammation in a short period of time can be helpful, is necessary actually for your body. It's necessary. It's necessary in several ways, but the most one, the one that I want to bring out today is it's necessary for healing, okay? Now, the example I want you to think of is, let's say you get a cut on your hand. In order to heal that cut, what has to happen? Well, we got to stop the bleeding, first of all, right? But then we have to recruit some new cells to come in there and create new skin, right? And we have to send a signal to the body that that area is painful. You shouldn't overuse it right now because we're trying to grow some new tissue. So we got to get the parts to come together like this. We don't want you tugging on this new cut, right, on your new scar. So there's a whole process of cells being recruited, new tissue being created, pain, and a little bit of swelling, and that's inflammation. And that's good. If it didn't happen, your cut would just be hanging out there bleeding. There'd be no healing to that, right? So inflammation is vital for a short period of time to get things healed and get things on track, okay? And let's talk about this. This is probably the number two most important slide of my whole talk, right here. The healing cascade, okay. On the left, so this is wound healing. If something happens to you, you get a cut on your hand, or you tear a ligament in your knee, or you overstretch one of your ankle ligaments, it doesn't matter. That's all wound healing, and it's all right here under this category. The first one is inflammation. This goes on about 4 to 6 days. And basically, cells rupture, and cells release signals. This would be like the local skin cells, the local tissue there. And then they release these signals that say, I'm damaged, I'm hurt, we need to create a healing response, okay? And then platelets come in. Platelets have a very important role in this. We're going to talk about that more. Platelets come right in, and then they lay down this mesh that stops the bleeding. Things get caught in the mesh. It's like a big spider web. You'll see a picture of that in a minute. And then platelets release a bunch of growth factors that recruit more cells to come in. Stem cells, okay, come in at this point. And then the growth factors from the platelets direct those cells what to do. So the stem cell shows up and the platelet says, we need to regrow some skin, or we may need to regrow some a nerve. We may need to regrow some hair. We may need to regrow whatever different kind of tissue. And so the growth factors from the platelets then direct these other cells of what to do. Take-home message here is that prolotherapy and PRP work right on this first area right here of inflammation, okay? We're trying to create a nice, healthy dose of inflammation so that the process gets started right. Think about it like starting a fire, right? Sometimes your fire just doesn't catch, and you've got something just smoldering and sitting there, and it's just throwing off smoke. It didn't really catch, right? That's you when your ligament didn't really heal. You got a little bit of a bump of inflammation, but your body didn't really jump on it the way it should have, and things just stalled out, and you got maybe 25% healing, something like that. So the logic of prolotherapy, the logic of PRP is to go back. We got to revisit that very first point. We got to spark that thing, hit it with some gas, you know. Remember, my stepdad used to say, now we're cooking with gas. You know, that was one of his sayings. So that's what we have to do with this wound healing. We got to get this thing cooking with gas again right initially. If we do that, spark it up right, and if your body's capable of responding with the other cells, like you have decent enough circulation, for example, and some other things, then the stem cells, other cells will come in, and then you can progress on down the line. Here's another interesting point from this slide. There's the last phase on the edge. It's called remodeling, right? Remodeling. That means all the tissue's laid down, but now it's kind of like it's tightening up, and it's kind of getting reorganized, and it's getting in good shape. Think about that like you're putting stucco on a wall. At first, you might just slap some stucco up there, but then the guy's going to come back, and he's going to remodel it in a sense, right? He's going to stroke it. He's going to get it lined up right. It's got to look pretty. It's got to fit. So at first, the cells are rushing in. They're just dumping down new tissue. But then there's a whole remodeling phase that has to happen to get all the collagen lined up right and get things tight and get it to top form. What's interesting, if you look here, I don't know if you can see, but the remodeling phase, it says 21 days, 3 weeks, okay, out to what? 2 years. Wow. Hello. So an injury I had 2 years ago is potentially just finishing up remodeling right now. So that takes some time. That takes some time. And that also takes basically exercise, okay? Because in order to remodel, you have to send your body signals how you want it to remodel. It just dumped a bunch of tissue on there, but you got to tell it, well, I want it to strengthen up in this way, and I want things to lay down in this way. If not, you just get a bunch of disorganized tissue. So a classic example is an ankle sprain that doesn't heal. Person has an ankle sprain, bunch of new tissue gets down there, but unless you put weight on it, unless you actually start to move your ankle, your ligament doesn't heal in tight. The collagen is what we call disorganized in medical language. The fibers are just going every which way. They're not lined up like this. They're not in nice coiled springs. They're just kind of disorganized. And so this person says, well, my ankle never healed. Well, did you go to physical therapy? Yeah, I went once, twice. You know, I didn't like it. It hurt. I know, I stopped. And so they didn't progress with their remodeling. They got a 25% healed ankle. How are we going to get it better? We got to go back to the beginning. We got to spark up the inflammation, and then we have to beg, plead, and, you know, manipulate to get you to participate in strengthening that somehow. Because you're sending signals of how you want the body to remodel. And that goes on for up to 2 years after the injury. All right? Very key idea. Okay. Well, let's move forward a little bit. What is prolotherapy? Just think of the word, the prefix prolo, and that is coming from proliferative. Okay? So we're doing an injection. We're trying to get tissue to proliferate there. Historically, there have been different kinds of solutions used. Now there's mainly just two, but I'm only going to talk about one, which is dextrose. Okay? That's why there's a picture of dextrose up here. What is dextrose? This was interesting. I actually found something out as I did a little research. Dextrose is basically the same thing as glucose. Okay? We've all heard the word glucose. Dextrose, if you look for the scientific name of dextrose, the scientific name of dextrose is D-glucose. It's D-glucose. Well, what's the other kind of glucose? There's something called L-glucose. Okay, fine. The overwhelming predominant form of glucose in nature and in your bodies is the D-glucose. Okay, so you can just think of dextrose as a brand name for D-glucose. Okay, so it's that simple sugar that's circulating in your blood right now. When you get your blood sugar checked and your blood glucose checked, this is what we're talking about. Okay? Now, it so happens that we've discovered historically that cells, if you put a little bit of glucose on them, they'll start secreting growth factors. And if you increase the concentration a little bit, they'll start this inflammatory process that we talked about. Okay? And this was discovered through lab research and trial and error, that kind of thing. So at this point, we know with specific concentrations of dextrose, aka glucose, we can stimulate cells to start growing and start healing again. And that's the basis of prolotherapy. The history of it actually goes back a long ways. The history of it goes back to Hippocrates, okay, ancient times in Greece. And they had javelin throwers participating in the Greek Olympics, right? Now, you can imagine these javelin throwers are hucking this thing, and their shoulder might have a problem or two, right? And specifically, the front part of their shoulder. Their shoulder's under a lot of tension right here in the front, right? Just imagine. And so you're doing this repetitively, and you can imagine the strain on the ligaments in there, right? I mean, your shoulder, you're asking it to, like, store energy and then release, right? And store energy and then release. You just keep on doing this pumping motion with your shoulder. Well, those ligaments started to wear out after a while. These guys were having anterior shoulder pain. Their shoulders were loose. It was sliding around in there because of too much stretch on the ligaments. We talked about that, right? So what he was doing is he was actually taking hot pokers, okay, hot poker, and jamming that in the front of the shoulder capsule underneath the muscle, deep in there, to kind of like coil, you know, heat it up and coil it up and melt it and, you know, just tighten that thing up, you know. But it was very helpful, very helpful. In fact, these guys came out and their shoulder was stronger than before. It wasn't the same. It was actually stronger, okay? And this kind of, in a crude way, was the beginning of saying, hey, if we can, we got some damage, if we can go in there and jumpstart a very strong inflammation and healing response, maybe we can get new tissue laid down and maybe it can actually become stronger than before. So they were curing their shoulder pain from that. Okay, the next bit of history kind of moves into the 1800s. Here we have a picture of a hernia. Nowadays, you think of a hernia and you think, that's no big problem. You know, that's kind of routine. I go in and get my hernia cut out. Fair enough. In the 1800s, it wasn't like that, though. A hernia was a big deal. Okay, you might have this piece of intestine hanging out. I mean, it's unsightly. It's hard to live life. And it can get twisted and you could get gangrene of your intestines. You could die. People were dying of hernias. And if not dying, it was a very, you know, we would call it morbid condition to live with. It was, you know, not pleasant, causing impact of quality of life. So it was a big deal. So in the 1800s, this big question was, can we inject something right around that little tear, you know, to get the tissue to tighten up and put the intestine back inside there and then do something that'll tighten up that area so it won't pouch out again, right? So there was a lot of medical investigation going on. Well, what kind of injections, you know, how much volume, you know, where do we do it, and can we heal these hernias? And turns out they started getting very successful with it. Very successful. In fact, I was just reading an article that came out in the JAMA, the Journal of the American Medical Association, in 1937, and there was this quote from this doctor saying, we've got so successful with injections now, hernia surgery is probably just something that will be considered elective and kind of rare. Which was, I mean, like, wow, fantastic. They were that good with it back in 1937. Unfortunately, now it's all progressed very much down a surgical line. Who knows exactly why? You know, I can't explain all that. But they were very skilled back in the 1800s and early 1900s, actually repairing hernias with injecting solutions to strengthen up that tissue. Okay. Let's go more towards the 1940s, 1950s. Two key names, George Hackett and Gustav Hemwell. George Hackett, the name on top, was a surgeon in Ohio. And he was a trauma surgeon, so he was seeing a lot of back and neck injuries. And he was, first of all, became convinced that a lot of the problem was loose ligaments, damage to the ligaments of the neck and back. First of all, people oftentimes don't think that they have ligaments in their neck and back, or maybe it's not at the forefront of their mind, right? We think about ligaments in my knee, maybe my shoulder. Your back is full of these things. Your neck is full of ligaments, okay? They help hold your spine up. So in a traumatic situation such as a car accident, falling off a ladder, other things, the ligaments can become stretched, and when you have that, you have a problem, and a weak ligament is a painful ligament, right? So he was thinking, you know, a lot of what I'm seeing, I think, is just due to weakness of the ligaments of this person's spine. If we can inject something in there like they were injecting for hernias, maybe we could tighten these ligaments up and help their back and neck pain. That was his line of progress. And he was a very scientific type person as well, so he kept copious records of a couple thousand patients. He would publish these periodically. He also did a lot of research with what we would call basic science research. So he was working with rabbits, and he would inject rabbit tendons and then cut them out and see if they grew. I'm going to show you a picture in a minute, pretty neat picture. And he was having excellent rates of response. I mean, really good. So he published a couple series, including in the Journal of the American Medical Association, again, in the mid-50s. And for these patients with chronic back problems especially, he was injecting some of the ligaments down here around what we call the sacroiliac joint. And he was getting 80% cure rate, okay, which is phenomenal. These people had pain for a long time, and they were cured, meaning gone. Pain is gone, and you don't need to do any more shots because I'm cured. I'm done. It's a past episode. I move on in life. So he was around 80% when he could isolate those painful ligaments and get the prolotherapy right on there. And so that was very startling. And another doctor wanted to come talk to him about this. And that second doctor's name was Gustav Hemwall, as you see below. And so they met at a meeting in 1957. And Gustav Hemwall kind of became the chief student and protege of Dr. Hackett. And Gustav Hemwall, being younger, then brought this clearly into the 1980s and early 1990s, kind of just before where we are today. So we're very thankful for them. So here's an example. This is the neck, okay? You see all this tissue back here, right? Like, what is this? These are ligaments that hold up and support the bones of your neck. Do you think if you had a whiplash accident and your head is flopping back and forth, do you think this might be torn or strained? Okay. Well, what's this? This is your low back if you're looking at it straight behind like this. Okay? This is your low back looking straight behind. So this is the pelvis on either side, person's hip joint would be down there and down there. Spine's right in the middle. Well, oh my gosh, what's all this white stuff? Those are gigantic ligaments that come in there and help hold your pelvis to your back. Things are like ropes almost. Not quite as big as the Achilles tendon, but on order of magnitude, like one step below that. These are some of the biggest ligaments in your body. Right down here to hold your back and tighten it up against your pelvis. Okay? And there's something down there called the sacroiliac joint in specific, where the pelvis kind of arches in and attaches to your back. All right. George Hackett wrote a book. It was published in 1956. It's still in print. They're on the fourth printing of this thing. Amazing. It's a great book. It was about what he did to get his 80% cure rate for his back pain and neck pain by injecting selected ligaments. Here's a picture of his rabbit tendons, okay? Hopefully you can see on the left, this is the untreated rabbit. On the right, this is the treated rabbit. Same thing here. So it's bigger, it's more robust. I mean, look, it's kind of like if you had two drumsticks. This is kind of a bigger looking drumstick here on the end compared to that guy. So when he did these measurements, he was seeing the diameter of this tendon was increasing by, up to 60%. And the tensile strength very, very much increased too. This was done on rabbit tendons. Prolotherapy has been in the news. This is an article from 2007, August 7th, 2007, New York Times, injections to kickstart tissue repair. It was all about prolotherapy using dextrose. Had a quote from someone from the Mayo Clinic and some other places in there. Okay. Do you recognize this person? Yep, great man. I respect him very much. Former Surgeon General of the United States, C. Everett Koop. Right? Here's what's interesting. He was a patient who personally had several chronic pain problems cured by prolotherapy, by Gustav Hemwell, the student who kind of popularized it very much. And so when he had his chronic pain problems that were told this is intractable, it's incurable, you can't get better, and he was only 40 years old at the time, he ended up finding about Dr. Hemwell, getting some prolotherapy, dextrose prolotherapy, his problems went away. Now, I didn't disclose exactly what these problems were. He was a little mum on that. But it got so dramatically better that he started then practicing prolotherapy a little bit on his own. Let me share you a quote. Okay, this is from C. Everett Koop. I find this really striking, considering he was Surgeon General of the United States. I was so impressed with what prolotherapy could do for musculoskeletal disease that I, at one time, thought that that would be the way I would spend my years after formal retirement from the University of Pennsylvania. But the call of the President of the United States to be Surgeon General interrupted any such plans. Okay. Wow, interesting. Yeah, Ronald Reagan called him to be Surgeon General. Okay. Here's another example. I don't know if you may or may not recognize this gentleman. His name is Bodie Miller. Okay? Most Olympic medals of any American ski athlete, male or female. Right here, this man. He competed in, I think it was four different Olympics. Phenomenal ski racer from New Hampshire. Well, he had several devastating injuries along the way to his knees and was told basically his career was over. He went down to Ensenada, Mexico, got prolotherapy from a very, very famous doctor who's like in his late 80s, one of these early generation guys from like the 50s and 60s. Series of prolotherapy injections gave him his career back. He talked about it all over the media. If you just type in Bodie Miller knee pain, Bodie Miller prototherapy and stuff, you'll find it. So there are articles even written like ESPN magazine and stuff about this. This is probably about 2008, 2010. Okay. So if this is true, if the Surgeon General's talking about it, athletes are getting it, rabbit tendons are getting bigger, you know, people are curing 80% of back pain back in the 50s, you know, inquiring minds want to know, you're probably going to have a few questions. The first question is, why haven't I heard about it? Right? That's the first question. Why haven't I heard of it? There's a couple reasons for this. There were several case reports of complications that came out, and it put cold water on the fire for a while. It kind of put a big blanket on things, which is unfortunate. But that's how science progresses. It kind of fits and starts. So people got excited about doing these spine injections, and maybe people weren't quite trained. You know, they weren't following protocol and stuff. And then so there were like four or five complications that were pretty serious, like people getting paralyzed and getting infections in their spinal cord and stuff, which was obviously from the needle being in the wrong place. Simple as that. Also, they were using some injectate solutions that were pretty strong and pretty vigorous compared to what we use now. It was not just pure dextrose. They were using a bunch of stuff that was perhaps implicated in causing these problems. So when that came out, the mainstream medical establishment took a big step back and said, you know, we're not dealing with this. I mean, it's not ready for prime time. It's dangerous. And it kind of fell off a map for a while. Okay. That's one reason you haven't heard of it. The other reason you haven't heard of it is because it's not patentable, nor does it represent anything that's high tech, right? So it's kind of like that age-old question, if a tree falls in the woods, right, and nobody hears it, you know, did it make any noise, right? If dextrose prolotherapy could regrow cartilage and strengthen tendons and ligaments, but nobody's there to tell the medical profession about it, no spokesperson's knocking on the doctor's door saying, let me tell you how amazing this thing is, did it make any noise? Right. So that's one of the problems. You can't get a patent on injecting sugar water, basically, on somebody's joint. You know, you can't make a lot of money on that. So there's no commercial incentive. There's nobody getting behind this with their R&D budget, with their promotional budget, saying, hit the streets, get the word out. You know, I want every orthopedic surgeon in this place to know that. There's not that promotional army behind it. But it's hung on over the years because it's based on truth, ultimately. That's the fantastic part. It's always hung on. There's always been a sort of side stream of people that have known that this works. They just kind of keep at it. A lot of it's self-funded research. Why doesn't insurance pay for it? Good question. Okay. One big thing is that Medicare has a lot of power. And so what they decide not to pay for, other people, it's like monkey see, monkey do, and other insurers don't want to pay for it because it simplifies their life. Right? It's like Medicare spent all the money, convened a panel of 20 scientists, and figured out that they don't want to pay for that. Why would we do the same thing? Let's just say that, and let's just save our money. Okay, so that is a big reason. And also, some of the best research is kind of recent, maybe over the last 5-6 years. So, you know, that decision on what they do or don't pay for could have been made by a group that convened 10 years ago, right? And so there's going to be a lag, right, between actual science and then when stuff gets covered by insurance companies. So that takes some time. Okay, and the last kind of question that comes to mind is, it sounds too good to be true. And like I said at first, when I was on the, you know, reading the magazine and the newspaper, I'm like, is this too good to be true? What's with this? Right? Let me read you a quote again from C. Everett Koop. He wrote a foreword to a book about prolotherapy. This is from his foreword. Not many physicians are aware of prolotherapy, and even fewer are adept at this form of treatment. One wonders why this is so. In my opinion, it is because medical folks are skeptical. And prolotherapy, unless you have tried it and proven its worth, seems to be too easy a solution to a series of complicated problems that afflict the human body and that have proven notoriously difficult to treat by any other method. Another reason is the simplicity of the therapy. Injecting an irritant solution, which may be something as simple as glucose, at the junction of a ligament with a bone, to produce the rather dramatic therapeutic benefits that follow. Another very practical reason is that many insurance companies do not pay for it, largely because their medical advisors do not understand it, have not practiced it, and therefore do not recommend it. Okay, there we have. Let's shift gears for a second to talk about PRP, platelet-rich plasma, okay? What happens if you take a vial of blood and you spin it in a centrifuge? The answer is you see something like this picture, okay? And the blood separates out. You got your red blood cells which settle on the bottom, okay? You got white blood cells in there which you can't quite see. There's a little white layer in there, that's not the white blood cells, just FYI. But you got red blood cells in there, then you got white blood cells in there, and then you have these things called platelets, which are different, okay? And then you have just the plasma, which is like the fluid. That's where, you know, your vitamins are floating and, you know, what you just ate your last meal is floating through the plasma. So you got cells, red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets, and then there's just plasma sitting there. And that plasma is the yellow stuff you see on top. Okay. What is a platelet? Okay. Platelets are produced in the bone marrow. They're small little cells, and they have a short lifespan of about 7 to 10 days. That's it. But they're extraordinarily important. In fact, if you ever get your blood tested, right, you're going to have your platelet count, right? Do you know what I'm talking about? Right? It's going to tell you what your red blood cells, what your white blood cells, it's going to say what your platelets are. If you don't have enough platelets, it's a big problem, right? I mean, they'll keep you in the hospital if you don't have enough platelets because we got to get those things up because you got a bleeding risk here. If you get a cut or an injury and your platelets aren't functioning, you can't heal that cut, you're going to bleed out. It's a big, big problem. Platelets within them have very powerful growth factors. So when they go to the site of an injury, they release these growth factors that are spread out through the blood and the lymph fluid, and it attracts in other cells, as I said, to come repair the problem. So here's an example. I think this is a fantastic picture. This is an electron microscope. Okay, the platelets, you can see these little white things, actually. These are the platelets here. Okay. This is the mesh that they have secreted, which is something called fibrin. We call this a fibrin matrix. And then it's like a cobweb, so it's trapped other things. And in this case, it's trapped red blood cells, which are here. See that? Fantastic. Okay? That's the beginning of wound healing. PRP has been very much in the news. Lots of fancy athletes and big-name people have been getting this to try to help with their ligaments, tendons, typically problems. So here's some people. We all recognize Tiger Woods. Hines Ward, MVP of the Super Bowl a couple years ago, Pittsburgh Steelers. Brandon Roy played for Portland Trailblazers. Okay, these people have all had PRP injections. Usually it's their knees. History of PRP, it's actually been around a while. It was first used in 1987 in an open heart procedure. I'm not exactly sure why. I wasn't able to find that out in my research, but that's when it was first used. And then it was used a lot since then in plastic surgery and maxillofacial surgery. Okay, plastic surgery, maxillofacial surgery, as you can imagine, it's imperative to get the wound to heal, right? You've got to get the wound to heal. You've got to get the wound to heal right. And you're dealing with bone a lot of times. I mean, you might be digging out pieces of people's jaw and the bone. And so they started to have this idea, well, what if we inject a little bit of PRP, you know, right where we dug out some tissue, and we need to make sure we get the wound healing right. What if we just spritzed it with a little PRP while we were in the operating room? Would it help the outcome afterwards? Okay, and it was. And that was the logic. So this stream of study and medical application went forward for basically the last 20, 25 years. And then it kind of bridged over into orthopedic conditions in about 2006 with an important study of tennis elbow. Have you guys heard of tennis elbow? It's basically a tendon problem. And this doctor named Mishra, M-I-S-H-R-A, out in Palo Alto, started doing PRP on tendon problems for the elbow that wouldn't heal. Got good results. So that's where it came from. Let's look at a couple case examples, all right? A couple case examples. These are people I've all treated with prolotherapy. We'll go back to that for a second. These are people I've treated with prolotherapy, and I want to just talk through them. So 65-year-old woman with chronic ankle sprain that wouldn't heal. This is actually my mother-in-law. And she's a great lady. I love her. Okay, so I wanted to help her get better. And she was very active. She went to physical therapy. She did everything right. The MRI looked fine. This ankle just wouldn't heal. Anytime she had to walk up an incline, sharp pains in her ankle. She couldn't do her daily like Pilates and other type of workouts that she wanted to do because her ankle was just throbbing. It was really frustrating for her, limping around. This went on for 8-9 months. I said, you know what, let's try some prolotherapy on it. So I visited her one day down in California, brought my stuff. First time we did the shots, they're sore for a couple days. I hear back from her in a couple weeks, man, that helped, Mike. I really appreciate that. My ankle is feeling good. It's feeling good. Something good's happening down there. I can feel it tightening up. Okay, okay, good, great. You know, I talked to her a little bit later. That helped a lot. You know, I'm walking up the hill without pain. I feel great. Can we just do it one more time? I feel like I'm like 80% there. Can we do one more time? Okay. One more time. Done. She's is gone. She's cured. She's doing everything she wants in her ankle. Zero pain. No more shots needed. Two shots of prolotherapy. About a month apart. Why is that? Well, again, look at the ankles. See all these ligaments down in here? Can these get stretched? Can they fray? Can they partially detach from bones? Can they partially tear? Yes, they can. A weak ligament is a painful ligament. How are we going to heal it? We got to stimulate healing. And then we have to do some exercise around it to help it all remodel right. Okay, that's what she did. Here's another one. This is a 21-year-old man who was had a foot injury after playing basketball. Similar story. He got an MRI. Looked fine. That doesn't mean there's not a problem. We already talked about that. Orthopedic surgeon seeing a normal MRI says, I can't see anything to operate on, which is a fair statement, right? I mean, why go in and cut on something that you can't make better? It already looks good. Don't mess with it. He's like, just try some more physical therapy. The problem was this guy had already done physical therapy, probably like 9 months of it. He was in crutches. He was an RA at his dorm. He had responsibilities, okay? He's trying to get around his crutches. He's trying to get to his campus job. Not to mention, can't even think about playing basketball again. I was like, come on down, let's see what the problem is. Okay, oh, looky here, there's a bunch of ligaments in the foot. And I started poking around, and I found a couple spots that were just extremely tender and sore. I said, you know what, I think you have strained the ligaments in your foot when you fell, you know, awkwardly playing basketball. Let's do some prolotherapy now, let's tighten it up. Okay, I'm game. One shot, the crutches are gone, he's playing basketball, he's being an RA. He's doing great. 68-year-old gentleman who had been having shoulder pains right here in the front of his shoulders. This was bothering him a lot. He liked to do partner dancing, and he's lifting his arms like this and just start to have this very common shoulder pain or lifting anything, causing a lot of problems. He had a problem right in here called in the biceps tendon. You can see one of the tendons of the biceps comes up and loops around in there. That tendon was basically irritated on some level. We didn't get an MRI of his shoulder, so we don't know exactly, or even if an MRI could show the problem. But it was very clearly identifiable. I just put my finger on it right over that tendon. He said, oh, that hurts. That's my pain. It's like, let's do some prolotherapy on it. Let's strengthen that tendon. First shot, hurt for a couple days. Then he comes back. He's telling me, it feels good. You know, it's getting better. I like it. I think we're onto something. I'm dancing with, you know, less pain. I'm lifting stuff in the garden. I'm feeling real good. He's like, let's do it one more time. Okay. Second shot, did great. I haven't heard from him since, so I'm presuming that things are still going very well. He was extremely proud. He was extremely, it flipped the switch kind of in his mind. You know, he's like, wow, I mean, really? Wow. And he was an engineer, so he's a very analytical person. He was reading about prolotherapy and sending me articles and all kinds of stuff. It was fantastic. He had biceps tendon problem. Okay. Low back pain. We'll just skip this right now because our time is kind of tight. So I'm going to move forward pretty quick here. Let me just talk about this one versus the other. Bottom line is you can get the same results in the end, okay? And for the right condition, if we get the needle in the right place and do everything correctly, 80% cure is a fair number to offer. That's a fair statement. And upwards of 90% saying they feel better, maybe not cured, right? They're not totally, you know, haven't resolved the problem, but they feel significantly better. Those are fair numbers. PRP is more powerful, if you will. So one PRP injection is equivalent to about 3 prolotherapy injections. This is not science that you're going to go read in a textbook, but this is me talking to practitioners who've been doing both for a long time at national conferences, and they say, like, yeah, that's about 3-1, okay? But you will get to the same place in the end. You could take your time, do about 3 prolotherapy or 1 PRP, okay? PRP has a greater cost, though, and it's a little more invasive. You have to get your blood drawn. As I said, we've got to spin it down. We have to keep things sterile. We have to re-inject it. So it was a little bit more of a procedure. Prolotherapy is extremely simple, just get the glucose out and put it right in there. Okay. Typical cure, 3 to 4 Prolo shots, that's very generous. I just mentioned stories where 1 shot or 2 shots cured the person, right? So 3 or 4 is like saying your worst case scenario. That's just a huge margin of safety on it. Okay, and because PRP is a little more potent, maybe 1 to 2. Okay. I'm going to just go through and wrap up here a little bit. Is it worth it? I mean, compared to surgery, very much, I would advocate. The cost is lower, non-invasive. Recovery is minimal. In fact, we encourage you to be active right away. We encourage it because it helps with that remodeling process. So, who should not get it? If you have a significant difficulty healing, like you have poor blood flow, or you have diabetes, which will impair healing, or you're a smoker, that impairs healing, or you're taking drugs that suppress your immune system, like methotrexate or prednisone or something, those immunomodulatory drugs, those will impair healing. It doesn't mean you absolutely can't have it, right? But it just takes your odds of benefit and knocks it down a little bit. But just think of it this way. If you can heal from surgery, you could heal from prolotherapy. That's a lot easier to heal from, right? I mean, do we do surgery on people who smoke? Do we do surgery on people with diabetes? Do we do surgery on people on immune drugs? Yes, but you know, the outcome is not as robust as you would like. But if you can do surgery on it, you can certainly do prolotherapy on it, but just you have to be cautious a little bit accordingly. That's all. If you're on PRP, there's some dangers. We would not want to do PRP injection if you have cancer in your body because the platelets release a lot of these growth factors that's promoting growth in that area. We don't know if there's a malignant cancer cell that wandered into the mix, and we don't want to promote growth of that. So that's a no-go. If you have low platelets, that's a no-go too. The platelets have to be right. And if you're on antiplatelet medication like Coumadin, heparin, that kind of thing, okay, we would have to talk about that, maybe coming off that for a little bit of time, because those are antiplatelet medications. They interfere with blood clotting, which is necessary in that case, but it's also counterproductive to what we're trying to do, right? So that's why. I'll end with this slide. Basically, the risk is really nothing more than any injection, okay? We select patients carefully. We're very safe with our methods, so it's the equivalent of any injection, bleeding, infection, stuff like that. I'm going to just go to the last slide here to say thank you, all right? And I'll bring it.